founded in Chicago, Illinois in 1877, working to change lives through God's transformative love. Pacific Garden Mission serves with the compassion of Christ and ministers with the transforming message of the gospel. We are honored to have as our guests the president, the director, and program manager of Pacific Garden Mission. They will share how they practically and spiritually meet the needs of broken lives, helping them get back on their feet and starting towards a journey of transformation. Stay tuned to hear the powerful stories of hope.
Sovereign in the mountain air, sovereign on the ocean floor, with me in the calm, with me in the storm. Sovereign in my greatest joy, sovereign in my deepest cry, with me in the dark, with me at the dawn. In your arms, all the pieces of my life, from beginning to the end, I can trust you. In your never-failing love, you work everything for good. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you. I do, Lord. Sovereign in the mountain air, sovereign on the ocean floor, with me in the calm, you're with me in the storm. Sovereign in my greatest joy, sovereign in my deepest cry, with me in the dark, with me at the dawn. In your everlasting arms, all the pieces of my life, from beginning to the end, I can trust you. In your never-failing love, you work everything for good. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you. All my hopes, all I need, held in your hand. All my life, all of me, held in your hands. All my fears, all my dreams, held in your hands. All my hopes, everything I need is in your hands. All my life, all of me, Lord, all my fears, all my dreams, held in your hands. In your everlasting arms, all the pieces of my life, from beginning to the end, I can trust you. In your never-failing love, you work everything for good. God, whatever comes my way, I can trust you. God, whatever comes my way, I will trust you, Lord. God, whatever comes my way, I will
You're watching the Everlasting Love Program, and we want you to know that God loves you with an everlasting love. Now, it doesn't matter what situations you've experienced in your life, trials, struggles, things that may have happened in your past. God says, if you call on me, I will answer, because he loves you with an everlasting love. As you watch our program today, there might be some things that you see that interest you. You may want to get in contact with us if you're looking for a good church, if you need somebody to pray with you. During the course of the program, you'll see some information pop up on the screen. You'll also see a web link to our YouTube program. So feel free to reach out, feel free to contact us, and we would be more than happy to get back with you. I wanted to share a scripture with you from the book of Matthew. And it says, "For I was hungry, and you fed me. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me into your home. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you cared for me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then these righteous ones will reply, "Lord, when did we ever see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink, or a stranger and show you hospitality, or naked and give you clothing? When did we ever see you sick or in prison and visit you?" And the king will say, "I tell you the truth, when you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you were doing it to me." And that's what you're going to hear about on today's program. We're going to be talking to three gentlemen who are part of the leadership of Pacific Garden Mission. You're going to hear stories, and you're going to hear about this awesome ministry that actually serves individuals who fall into some of these categories in this scripture. So I want to welcome to the program my three guests. I'm going to start here with Pastor Phil Kwiatkowski, who is not just the pastor, but he's also the president of Pacific Garden Mission, so welcome to the program.
Good to be here. Thank you.
And also Pastor Samson Green, who is the Director of Ministries, welcome. And Angel Feliciano, who is the program manager. So thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
So before we actually get into the meat of the ministry, the services, the programs that it provides, I would like for you all to kind of talk a little bit about your own journey, how you all became believers, and then how you came to become a part of Pacific Garden Mission. So I'm going to start with you, Pastor Phil.
Yeah, it's a great question because our passion is the gospel. And I came to Christ in 1984. I'm from Chicago. I was raised Catholic, went to Catholic school, went to Brother Rice High School on the South Side, and went to Mass every Sunday, but I was working a job on the South Side. It was in Tinley Park. And a lady, a nurse, was there. Her name was Cosette Davis, and she was sharing the gospel with me. And you know, being religious, I was familiar with it, but really it was different that she was passionate about this, and it was real to her.
Mm.
She invited me out to church. It was a church on 107th and Vincennes, and it was Mother's Day. And she said, "Why don't you just come to church and whatnot?" So I went, and the guy got up, and he preached the gospel that day. Mm. He preached about being born again. And one thing he said, "Why don't you do your mother the greatest gift you can this Mother's Day and this by giving your heart to Jesus Christ?"
Wow.
And I did. I raised my hand, and he gave an invitation. I walked forward, and I prayed to receive Jesus Christ as my Savior. Mm. And I realized it wasn't good works. It wasn't being religious or being a part of a denomination. God does not weigh your good and the bad.
Yes.
I needed God's grace, mm-hmm. and that was through Christ. So I came mm-hmm. to saving faith in Jesus Christ in 1984. Mm-hmm. In 1986, I went to Moody Bible Institute, and then I got married in 87. So
it
was quick.
It's just happening.
I know. And then I went down to Pacific Garden Mission in 87 and or in 88, and I started working there. While I was a student at Moody, I was married, and I was uncertain about what God wanted for me. But when I went down there, my heart was broken because I saw the plight of the men and women on the streets, and I saw what a place like Pacific Garden Mission did for them. This place was not only feeding them and clothing them and giving them the basic necessities, they made it paramount that they hear the gospel.
Yes.
And men and women were getting saved.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd see folks from the streets that were doing dope, that were stealing, cheating, come to Christ. You see them changed. And then you see them a few months later, you meet their families, and then they graduate and they get jobs and they come back and visit. And I said, mm-hmm. this is what I want to be a part of the rest mm-hmm. of my life. missionaries go all around the world looking for people. People are walking through our doors.
Right.
And I've been there since 1988, and I've loved every moment of it.
Wow, that's amazing. 1988. So how many years is that
Over 29 years now.
Wow.
It's been a long time.
Yeah, that's pretty powerful, because a lot of times folks that are kind of in senior management, you know, there's a high transition rate.
Right.
But you've stayed there that whole time.
Well, the neat thing about it from my perspective is I got to do every job. Both of their jobs I've done. I've driven our vehicles. I've worked on our security. I've answered phones. I've done tours. So I've done every job. So there's not really an area of the mission that I'm unfamiliar with. So coming in my role now, I'm familiar with what everybody does and different roles. So again, it's passionate, but to see Jesus Christ changing lives. And that's why I love Pacific Garden Mission.
Yeah.
It's not the food. It's the gospel. So
it's the gospel.
That's what it is.
It's not the physical food.
Yes.
It's the spiritual food, right?
Yes.
Well, and you're witnessing people's lives just being transformed. Mm. We talk about God's everlasting love.
Yes.
You're experiencing that on a regular, you're part of providing that for folks on a regular basis.
Every day. And to see women and children, that's probably our largest growing segment, to see kids coming, walking through our doors. And to see, and we see every day, you see 18, 19-year-old young men. They should be in high school. They should be learning how to shave, but they're navigating life on the streets of Chicago. But I praise God that there's a place that they can go to
and
be encountered with the gospel of Jesus Christ, so they can see their life change. And that's exciting.
What makes you unique, too, is that you're not just a president, but you're a pastor.
Yes.
So you have the heart of a shepherd.
Amen.
And that's what's critical. So not the administration side of things only, but also
the pastoral
side. Powerful.
Yes, thank you.
So what about you, Pastor Sampson? I hear you actually have a little movie coming out about you in the near future. So tell us your story.
Well, I come to Pacific Garden Mission in 95. I've been part of one of the largest gangs here in Chicago for about 25 years. And we were going through some issues with the gangs in Inglewood. That's where I was living. Mm-hmm. And my girlfriend said, man, you got to get out of town. You know, it's just too much going on. And I didn't really want to go, but at the same time, I didn't want to bring any drama to my family. Mm-hmm. So I was on my way to Ohio. I went down to the Greyhound bus station, and the bus would only come at 2 a.m. every morning. And I would fall asleep, so I missed the bus 3 days in a row. And so I was there, and both my hands were in casts. I had broken both my hands beating a guy prior to that. And I got on the phone. I just called my girlfriend and said, hey, listen, you know what? I'm just coming back. You know, whatever happens. They kill me, I kill them. You know, I'm tired of running. And while I was talking to her on the phone, a guy stepped to me, says, I know where you can go. And I was kind of like, man, you know, who is this guy? And he just blurted it out. He says, you can go to Pacific Garden Mission, get you some rest, and you can catch your bus the next day. And so my girlfriend, listening to him on the phone, said, "What? Yes, why don't you do that? Go down there to Pacific Garden Mission, and then in the morning, you can, you know, the next day, you have enough sleep, you can catch the bus and take off." And so I'm thinking, like, I don't want to go to a mission. This place is going to be dirty, nasty. All these bums are going to be there. And the guy then offered and said, hey, I carry your bags for you, because he's seen I had cast on my hands. So now I'm thinking, wait a minute, this might be a setup. And it was freezing cold. It was February. It was snow outside. Mm-hmm. It was cold. And I'm figuring something may happen when I step outside. So I just said, forget it. Let's go. And we went outside of the place, outside of the Greyhound bus station, started walking down Harrison. We got to State Street. Returned the corner, and there it was, this big old sign that says, Jesus Saves. Mm. And I said, oh, no, I don't want to go in there. Mm. You know. And so when we went inside, there was a guy standing there, and he says, welcome to Pacific Garden Mission. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying to myself, no, this guy was 10:30 at night. He has it on a suit. He's smiling. I said, why is he smiling at 10:30 at night at a homeless shelter? But anyway, we went to, it was time for to go upstairs to go to bed, and I'm just sitting there thinking about my life. You know, why am I here? And the next morning, they woke us up about 5:45 a.m. in the morning. And I'm like, well, why are we getting up this early in the morning? He says, where are they going to have service? Service? What service? He says, they're going to be preaching about Jesus. I say, who want to hear about Jesus at 5:45 in the morning? And so we went down, and man, this guy was preaching like it was 3 o'clock in the evening, and he's just preaching the gospel, and I'm just unrest with what he's talking about. Then 8 o'clock comes. They have an 8 o'clock Bible study. I'm like, man, that's all they do in this place. And and it was cold outside. It seemed like it was really, really just cold outside. And I'm like, no, I can't go out there now. Uh-huh. So noonday service came, and there was this guy. His name was Pastor Hagerman. He started preaching the gospel, and at the end of his message, he asked a question. He says, if you were to die today, where would you spend eternity? And that thought just ran through my mind, and I just wanted to get out of there. And I seen some men who were raising their hand, you know, saying they want to, you know, talk about this invitation. And so when I seen them raise their hand and they went outside the door, I raised my hand. I said, that's my way out of here. And I went right out of there and walked right into the prayer room. And there was a guy standing there with the Bible.
That was a setup, right?
Yes, it was a
setup. God set that one up.
Exactly.
Right?
So I walked right into the prayer room, and there's a guy with a Bible in his hand. And he says to me, he says, can I show you in the Bible how to be saved? And man, it seemed like my whole life just started flashing through my mind. And I told him, I said, man, nobody can save me. And he says, Jesus can. And so we went through the gospel plan. I believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. I got saved that day. And then he told me about a Bible program at Pacific Garden Mission. And so I wanted to know more about this Jesus that loved me so much and that would give himself for me. And I joined their Bible program, and the rest is history. You know,
what an amazing story.
Yeah.
That God's love covers a multitude of sins.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
What I think is interesting, you know, because sometimes folks will say, I don't have such an interesting testimony like that, right?
Right.
You know, so here we're talking to Pastor Phil, and he's like, yeah, you know, I was Catholic, I got saved, I went to Moody.
Sure.
And that, to me, is just as powerful.
Yes, it is.
As a story of, as like your story, Pastor Sampson, when you were in, you know, you were in this gang, and it's just as powerful. And you're both sitting next to each other, and God is using both of your lives,
and
he uses them in different ways.
Yes.
You know, I want to ask you a question before we transition to Angel, because I know, too, that, you know, you talk about, you had shared with me earlier that then you just, you know, stayed with Pacific Garden Mission.
Yes, ma'am.
But why gangs? Can you think back that far? And what was the attraction or the draw?
Well, you know, when my mother was very young when she birthed me. I think she was about the age of 14 years old. And when I was a very small boy, we lived on 47th and Oakenwald. That's in the Brownsville area over there, way, or High Park area. Mm-hmm. And at the time, they had the Black Peystone Rangers and that kind of stuff, the Black Panthers and all that was around. And these gang members were standing in our building's doorway, and my mom went to ask them to move away from our door, and those gang members began to jump on my mom. And at that time, I was like, never, that'll never happen again to my family. I didn't like them. And so anything that was opposite of them, that's what I wanted to be. It didn't, you know, no one jumped me in. Nobody made me do it. Mm-hmm. This is something I went because of what I seen happen. And I, you know, these guys were supposed to have been part of the community, you know, helping out the community. Mm-hmm. But that wasn't it at all. You know, when they jumped my mom, that was the end of it. And from that point on, you know,
You became involved with gangs?
Well, it was really, I grew up around it.
Okay.
In Joliet, Illinois, I went to school there. My mom sent me from, you know, grade school because my grades started going down.
Yes,
I was a
yes.
really good student, but my grades started going down. Mm-hmm. She sent me to live with my grandmother. My grandmother was like the Gestapo. Mm-hmm. And so I went to school there. And then, you know, we lived right up the street from the Joliet Correctional Center. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the, you know, we stayed in the projects in Joliet, Illinois.
Sure.
And there were a lot of gang infestation
okay.
there. And so a lot of them knew me, but I got into sports, so I wasn't really
okay.
involved in
okay.
the gangs at the time. But after I graduated high school and people knew me, and, you know, I had a lot of those guys were my friends and that kind mm-hmm. of thing. And I just started hanging out. And I went to DePaul University. I moved back to Chicago. I went to DePaul University my freshman year, and made some bad choices. I wanted to play basketball there, and things just didn't work out.
Okay.
And so I began to hang out with the gangs.
Okay.
Start, you know, using, drugging, getting involved, and next thing you know, I was there.
Okay.
You
All
know,
right.
It was that was it.
Okay. And today you're the father of like four or five.
Yes.
Four.
I have four children.
Four.
Yep.
And you have.
Four boys and one girl.
I mean, wow. We're talking about the transformative power of Jesus.
Yes. The neat thing about it is that when he came and joined the program, I did his intake.
Yes.
And I remember the day he came because his hands were broken.
Ah.
So we had a security, and our security director said, he said to me, he called him Big Man. He said, Pastor, I want Big Man on security. I said, Big Man needs to go upstairs and read his Bible. He doesn't need to be on security.
Okay, all right.
So I remember the day he came.
Happened to me. That was the best thing that ever happened to me. Because I don't think I'd have last if I'd had to do security and engaged with anyone at that time.
Yeah.
And but he sent me upstairs, and man, I got into the Word of God and just began to read my Bible,
That's
and
right.
God began to
That's
just,
right.
you know, feed me and nurture me, and you know. And
the power
I
of discipleship.
Jesus.
Yes.
So though I have two sons, I really have three. He's my other one.
Yes.
He looks more like my mother, but
the brother, the son
that's
from
right.
another
there
mother,
you go.
Or
that's
whatever.
That's right.
Okay. Good. Good. Well, thank you for both. You know, both for sharing that. That's really powerful. Angel, you've been sitting quietly over there, but I know there's some good stuff here. So tell us a little bit about your story.
Well, I came to PGM in 2012. I was coming from Wisconsin. I was born in Lorain, Ohio, but I grew up in Puerto Rico. So I started dealing with drugs around 19 years old. And that was because it was very hard to find a job in the area that I was living at. So the easiest way to make money was by dealing drugs. And at that time, I was already divorced. I got married when I was 17, divorced at 19.
Mm.
So, and I had a child, and I needed to pay child support. And in Puerto Rico, they'll put you in jail right away.
Okay.
So once I started getting behind in my child support because I couldn't find a job, I decided I was going to make some money somehow. So that led to many years of just dealing, working, and using from time to time. Not it was in using all the time, but from time to time. I came to the States when I was 21, and I continued that same route. I was living in Ohio, and I was working, and on the weekends I would use, but at the time I was not dealing anymore. It wasn't until perhaps 2005 or so, 2002, that I started dealing again. I guess it was one of those things everybody was doing. You make a lot of friends when you're involved in that. Never belonged to a gang. For some reason, the one time that I did try to join a gang, they didn't let me. The person didn't want me in the gang. And I think it was because he knew my family or he knew where I came from. He was trying to protect me from that.
Okay.
I really believe so. But. So I was I became a truck driver at the age of 24. I would deal just to have friends, and I would use occasionally on the weekends. Around 30 years old, perhaps 2002 or something like that, I became involved in. I started using more and more than what I used to. That was because I used to have this route from Chicago, from Aurora actually, to Cleveland and back to Aurora.
Mm.
So that was every day, over 800 miles. So in order for me to stay awake, I would figure anything out just to stay awake. Well, I became hooked up or addicted. In 2004, I became very aggressive and had a lot of problems at my house. I had my own house, I had several trucks, and everything was going well, but I started having problems with my family, with my ex at the time, or my ex now, and she kicked me out. I ended up going to live with my mom's house, who just came from Puerto Rico, to find out that she had cancer.
Mm.
So that was about 6 months, and I started getting deeper and deeper into drugs. It was about 6 months from the time she came here to the time she died. Once she died, that was in 2005, December of 2005, so that's when I started using very heavily, and I became homeless. I lost my CDL because of a DUI. And after I lost my CDL, I lost everything else. So I became, I just wanted to live in my car, I guess because the little bit of money that I had, I wanted to use it. And I didn't want to be responsible for bills, child support, nothing at that point. It's just like I didn't care anymore. So I started traveling. I went from Lorraine, went to Wisconsin, went back to Lorraine, and went back to Wisconsin. And in Wisconsin, I started, I went through the cold, bitter winter underneath a Walmart. They got a parking lot underneath. But in the midst of all that, I used to listen to Unshackled all the time, especially when I was a truck driver. And I used to listen to these stories as I was traveling through Arizona or Nebraska on this long trip. So I always knew that there was this place in Chicago called Pacific Art Mission. And I remember saying, I would like to go visit that place one day. That was when I was doing well economically. I didn't think I was going to end up there as a homeless man. So one day, I lost my job that I had in Wisconsin because of the addiction, and I started getting into certain places that I shouldn't have. So it came to a point where I needed to get away from Wisconsin. So I took off from Wisconsin. I started traveling towards Chicago looking for Pacific Garden Mission, and I ran out of gas on the way here. Remember, it was a very cold night. It was in December. It was December 23rd of 2011. And I ran out of gas, waited till the next day. I called my uncle. He sent me $10. With those $10, I put gas in the car, and I took off. Actually, I bought a donut, and the rest I put in the gas.
And at that time, $10 probably gave you a lot more gas than it would today, right?
It did. And, of course, I didn't pay none of the tolls. I just went through every toll until I made it to PGM. And when I parked outside, I said, well, I'm here. You know, I'm finally at this place where it's going to help me. And I'm going to get my life together. And as I was growing up, when I was growing up, I knew about Jesus. I knew about him, but I don't think, and it was one of those in Puerto Rico, they always call to do the altar calls. And I went up there, I don't know how many times, to give my life over to Jesus. I just don't think it ever actually happened. I think it was just performance. So it wasn't until I made it to PGM, and then I wrestled with that for 2 weeks. I did not want, I found out about the program, and they told me that I couldn't work. I just got a loan on my van about 3 months ago, one of those title loans. I said, I need to work because if not, I'm going to lose my van. And I can't lose my van because that was my home. That was really what I think it was my safety net, my safety blanket, or however you want to call it. As long as I had a van, I was running. So I would go inside the mission and I would sleep outside in my van because I didn't want to sleep inside. And then I didn't want to join the program because they told me I couldn't work. It was part of the program. I said, no, I need to work. One day, somebody was preaching and they were talking about Jacob and how Jacob was wrestling with God. And he said, the preacher said that a lot of us wrestle with God all of our lives until God dislocate our hip. And that's when we give up. And I remember I looked up to the ceiling and I was thinking about the program. I said, Lord, if you want me to join this program, you're going to have to dislocate my hip.
Oh, I love it. You challenged God. I love it because he always wins.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, that was one of those, what are you thinking? You know? So I did say that, and it was 2 days later that I took off to go to a job. I went to a labor-ready place, and I knew that day they were going to have work. And I take off, and my van runs out of gas. So I pull over to the side, or I push the van over to the side. There was another guy with me, and we started walking to the place, the labor place. When we got there, they said all the jobs were gone. So I don't have any money. I was thinking, well, I'll make some money today. I'll be able to put gas in my van. We'll get back. So by the time we walk all the way back to where the van was, it was gone. It was towed. So at that moment, I said, maybe this is not the right street. Maybe I'm just at the wrong place. I looked around, and I remember seeing this Camaro. And I remember that Camaro in the morning when I left the van. And I said, no, this was the place. This is where it was. So I sat down, and I started crying. It was more of a laugh, cry, like I could not believe it. And I realized, I said, God dislocated my hip.
Dislocated your hip.
Because I'm not from Chicago. I'm from Ohio.
That's so good.
And I was like, what am I going to do now? So I started walking.
Did you eventually then end up back at Pacific Garden Mission?
Mm-hmm. I walked all the way back, mm-hmm. which, by the way, my shoes were broken. I had to pull the bottom of my shoes off because they got on glue the night before. Yeah. So I pretty much walked barefooted all the way back to the mission.
Wow.
And it still waited till the next day because I still didn't know, I got to find my van. Maybe I can get it back out. Well, I didn't have enough money to get it back. The next day I joined the program.
Wow.
And that was...
That is so good. It's almost like you could preach a sermon about the dislocation of what is your hip?
Right.
Is it your van?
Right.
Okay, don't go preach this message.
Yeah, right. I'm taking notes. Go ahead.
Is it your van?
Yeah,
Is it your girlfriend? I don't know, whatever. Right.
That's true.
That is so, wow, that's really powerful. So both of you really changed, your lives changed, and I know there's probably so much more you could write books about it by this amazing ministry called Pacific Garden Mission. And your heart changed, Pastor Phil, when you went there and saw how God was using that place to feed and clothe and help people sleep. And not just that, or provide them a place to sleep, but help them back on their feet.
Yes.
And, you know, your program manager, your director, and you have a zillion stories on the website. I know zillion is being a little... ambitious there,
but there's a lot of stories there.
But talk to us about this ministry, Pacific Garden Mission.
Well, it's an amazing ministry. And because the heart of this ministry and what I believe makes this ministry different, that is not our focus, is the food, shelter, and clothing.
Right.
We do those things. We offer a lot of social services. Mm. We have a drug and alcohol program. It's a 90-day program where men and women that are struggling with an addiction can come and they be set free. We have a new life program, a discipleship program. We have career development. We offer GED classes to get people back in society again.
Okay.
But the heart of it, it's the gospel message. Mm. And that's what changes people.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right.
And there's nothing that I have seen that can make an angry person peaceful, to put a marriage back together, to set somebody free from an addiction, to change somebody's life outside of the gospel.
Mm.
And that's the heart of Pacific Garden Mission. Really.
Amen.
Real quick, there was a young man that was sitting outside of my office one day, and I went out there, and he was like 18 years old. He was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
And I am, what brings you here? He said he was from Indiana. And so I said, what brought you here? And he said he had some issues with his parents, and he was on the run, and he came here. And I shared the gospel, and he did. He prayed to receive Jesus Christ, and he joined the program. So it was on a Monday, I went to check on him, and I asked Pastor Green, I said, how's that young man doing? And he said he was in one of the classes and he wanted to talk to Pastor Green after class. He said, remember that guy? He said, I murdered somebody in my hometown. That's why I'm running.
Mm-hmm.
He said, now because of what's happened to me, he said, my conscience has been awakened.
Mm-hmm.
I need to get this right. So he wanted to turn himself in. But only the gospel can do that.
That's right. Mm-hmm. It's the convicting power of
the
Holy
Spirit. It's not just
giving
a guy a bowl of soup.
That's right.
And that's a story I remember when you look at these faces, and in the winter we'll see up near 1,200 people a night. But there's stories behind that. A young man like that, an 18-year-old kid who can join our program, receive Christ.
Yes, yes.
And he says, now I need to get this right.
Yes.
That's
yes.
Pacific Garden Mission.
Yes. Well, I want you to talk about homelessness, but I really want our audience to like really hone in on what you're saying, right? This is the evidence here, right? When we talk about this, this is not about somebody getting religion.
No.
I mean, this is about somebody hearing the word of God that is alive.
Yes.
You know, and having a relationship with a God who is alive, and his name is Jesus.
Yes. Right? That's right.
Amen. That's right.
And nobody else can do that.
That's right.
It's not, there's no magic potion.
No.
You said, I heard that word about the dislocation of a hip, of his hip.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I mean, come on, right? Yes. Like, you could read that and it doesn't mean anything, but when that word was spoken, it had power.
Yeah.
And you talk about, you know, the message that you heard when it was, you know, shared with you.
The invitation,
That invitation, it just changed your life. Mm-hmm. And so I guess we want people to know that this is not about some denomination or religion, but it's about a relationship with the living God.
Mm-hmm.
And so talk about homelessness, because most of these people that are coming are people that are on the street. What's going on with homelessness in this city, Pastor?
You know, the question is varied because there's a lot of contributing factors of homelessness. You have some women that are escaping domestic situations.
Feel free to chime in, too, while Pastor's...
Sure. Yeah. We have a young lady with us, lady with the twins,
who her
husband died in a car accident on a Lakeshore Drive, and she's left with these twins and nowhere to go. Mm. She's homeless. Addiction does play a role for many of them. We have Chicago, we have a drug problem. A lot of our men and women come to us with some form of addiction. Mm-hmm. But then you have jobs. Some folks, their job runs out, they don't know where to go. You have some older folks that they don't have the resources and they come to places. So there's various reasons that people come to us, but I believe there's really one reason. Whatever the reason is to hear the gospel message of Jesus Christ. And as you said, not to get church or religion or get good, but to get Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And what we're seeing really it grow worse in the city. As I mentioned earlier, we're seeing we're going to have to expand our women's and children's division.
Yes.
We've met on that recently. Yeah. We're seeing more kids, women with children than we've ever seen before.
Mm. Young women with children.
Yeah, these are 18-year-old, 19-year-old kids with kids. Mm-hmm. And whatever the parent did, the kid is always innocent.
Yeah.
And we're seeing younger men and women.
Yeah.
We go in our day rooms sometimes and we see and we try to talk with them, 18, 19-year-old, because as a father, I think, you know, that could be my son.
That's right.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the heartbreaking thing of homelessness when you hear some of the stories behind the faces that you meet.
So talk about what happens, right? Like I walk into Pacific Garden Mission and I'm homeless.
Mm-hmm.
What happens? What transpires after that?
When a young man or a young lady comes in, we have what we call guest services. They meet with them, you know, try to find out what their physical needs are. Because when you come in and you're hungry or you it's been raining outside, all you want is to change your clothes or something to eat.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the first things first, is to meet their physical needs. And then they are able to talk and listen. And then we share with them the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, we find out what brought them to Pacific Garden Mission, and then we tell them, you know, the gospel. Once we share with them the gospel, they go through intake, you know, get their information, and then we offer them one of three programs. We have the transit resident program where you can come in and out for the next 30 days. And then we have the new day recovery program. If you're struggling with drugs and alcohols or any type of addiction, doesn't have to be drug and alcohol, but what any type of addiction. And then we have our new discipleship program, which is the new life program.
Mm.
They can come in if they make a profession of faith. Now we want to disciple them, help them grow, get settled.
Right. That's right.
And then our life skills portion, which is we call career development,
where
we help them get back into society, working, jobs. Some of them want to go to school, never been to school, so we provide GED and things to help them get back into school.
Mm.
And then, you know, depending on what their call is, if God has called them, then maybe even ministry.
Mm.
We've had several people going to Christian colleges and doing well. Matter of fact, one of the men at our Pacific Guard Mission is now a program counselor at Pacific Guard Mission, graduated from Day Spring Bible College, and now he's here as a counselor. And so, you know, God is doing some wonderful things through the ministries of Pacific Guard Mission. So when a homeless person come in, they're no longer homeless.
Yes. Mm.
You know, they come and find a home.
Yes.
And that home is heaven.
And what's awesome about this is they're not paying anything.
They're not paying anything.
You know, and that's what makes this even more powerful, right?
Yes.
This is just like Jesus feeding the multitude, right?
Yeah.
Like the scripture we shared at the beginning. It's just so powerful. Nothing's expected from them
except
to come in and kind of surrender, yield themselves, right, to what you're doing.
It's like God using all of those various situations to bring them to himself.
Yes.
Because many of us, as long as we're doing well, we might not have anything to do with Jesus at all.
Mm-hmm.
But the Bible says in John chapter 6 and verse 44, it says, "No man can come to me except the Father which sent me, draw him,
I
will raise him up in the last day.
Right.
And so I believe God is allowing these situations to draw them to himself so that he can give them a greater hope than they've ever had. And that hope is in Jesus Christ.
Yes, yeah. I want you all to think of, and I know you're a program manager there, Angel, but think of stories that have really touched you? Because you said you serve, Pastor, you said you serve like 1,200 people?
In the winter, we can serve up to 1,200 people a night. Yes, yeah. And we have.
And I know you have statistics on your website of the number of people. I think you have it broken down by gender, and I'm not sure how else it's disaggregated. But you know, some of the stories. I had a chance to go on, and I looked at a couple. I saw Kalia and Dustin's story on there, and maybe that's not who we're going to, you know, you want to talk about. But since I mentioned their name, you can go on to their website and you can hear their stories. But what are some stories that just really impacted you? I'd love to hear some.
Yeah, you know, I think there's so many I can think of. You know, there's one fella that we just were with last month. His name is Tommy Pickens, and he's going to be Lieutenant Colonel in the Army. He came through the doors. We knew him well in 92, got saved from the south side of Chicago, drug background, like anyone else, just homeless. Accepted Christ, and after he graduated the Pacific Art of Mission, went to Bible school, wanted to be a chaplain. Now he's married, has children, he's gone around the world, he's been baptizing people in Iraq.
Oh my
now
goodness.
He's going to pin me as a lieutenant colonel. Those are the stories.
And this was a homeless
this
person.
This is a homeless, a young guy, Tommy Pickens, came through our doors with a drug issue. And no GED, nothing, no high school. And I was going to be lieutenant colonel in the United States Army.
Oh, come on.
So that's, again, that's the power
like
of God.
Like I want to get up and shout or something, but so, I have to be dignified here.
And just quickly, because so many, I did want to share Virgil.
Please, please.
He's 93 years old. He's an older gentleman. And one of the ministries we have a fellow that goes in our men's day room, and he just prays with the guy, shares the gospel. He's kind of the day room chaplain. His name is Phil Lacey. He saw an older man just sitting there quietly. And he said, Virgil, the name was Virgil. He said, how can I help you? How can I pray for you? And Virgil said, you know, I have daughters that I have not seen in 40 years. And he said, really? So Phil went on this crusade to go ahead and try to find the daughters. And he called various people with the same last name and to no avail. And the last person he talked to, he said, are you related to a Virgil? And she said, who are you? She said, well, I'm Phil Lacey. I'm from a homeless shelter in Chicago. She was in California. She said, that's my father's name.
Oh, my God.
So we've been looking for that man for 40 years. They've hired private detectives. You know, they thought he was gone. And he said, no, he's right here. So we arranged a reunion. And to see a clip, and I showed you the clip earlier.
And it's on your Facebook.
It's on our Facebook, Pacific Art of Mission Facebook. Yes. Scroll down, you'll see it. But just to see a man and his two daughters that he has not seen in 40 years. He's missed their high school graduations, their weddings, the birth of their children, their college graduations. And it seemed like none of that mattered. Time stood still. They were with their father again. And to see them reunited, I thought, that is an absolutely an amazing story. And those are the stories behind the faces that you see. You see a Tommy Pickens, now who's a lieutenant colonel. You see a Virgil, a man who's longing for a relationship with his family, and they're reunited again. That's what the Pacific Art of Mission does.
Yeah, and that's why you keep staying there.
That's why we stay there,
Exactly.
You know, whoever was waiting for promotion to president, it ain't going to happen for a while.
That's exactly right. Exactly right. There you go.
That's good. Amen. How about you, Angel? Is there a story that stands out for you?
Well, actually, of course, like Pastor Phil said, there are so many stories. Young men that come to the mission and they don't know anything about authority. They're disrespectful. They disrespected their parents, so they end up at PGM at 18 years old, not having a place to go at all. And we had a young man that, as he was going through the program, he would just get into so much little arguments and troubles. And it was until one day that he found himself back outside by his own choice, and something clicked that one day that he came back in and he said, Angel, can I have another opportunity to get back on the program? And I said, sure, but you have to start surrendering. You have to surrender to the Lord, because if you don't, you're going to continue to go through the same thing over and over and over. That was the last time that we had an issue with him to that extent. Of course, he was learning, so there were still a lot of things that he was learning throughout the program. He graduated two graduations ago. That was in May. He graduated in May. He is now working at Fisher.
Lawrence Fisher.
Mm. He is part of our hospitality desk, PGM. He works, so he works there part-time, and he works full-time outside at Fisher, Lawrence Fisher.
Yes.
And he has matured, and we're still working with him. We're still trying to help him to become that man that God is calling him to be.
Yes. Yeah, and I love this here, you know, three men of God, healthy, powerful, because we so need that in our culture, because fatherlessness really is the reason for a lot of the issues.
Yes, it is.
It's not the only one, but it's the reason for many of our societal ills right now. So that it's powerful to have men of God that are really on fire, you know, and willing to disciple young men. Pastor Green, what about you? Can you think of a story?
Just a few days ago, Pastor Phil and I were sitting in his office. We were just talking about things, you know, the ministry. And the director of our volunteers brought in a young man who had graduated our program. His name was Devin. He had come to us when he was maybe about 16 years old. He was there with his mother. And because he was 16 years old, he couldn't be on the mother's and children's side with his mother, so he had to either join the program. And so she turned, you know, she wrote and gave over custody to the Pacific Garden Mission of her son, and we put him in the men's Bible program. And we start talking with him, and you know, telling him what was expected of him, different men began to just witness to him while he was there and just talking to him about the Lord Jesus Christ. And so he went to Crane High School from the Pacific Garden Mission. Grades started shooting up. He was doing excellent in high school. He graduated high school, and he graduated the men's Bible program as well and went on to join the Navy. And we didn't hear from him for a while, but he came back, and while we were sitting there, he came in and just sat down and began to thank us for everything that he had learned at Pacific Garden Mission. He's taken a bold stand as a believer while being in the Navy, and that kind of thing just warms you, you know, when you see them come back and they share with you that they're still standing, that they're not wavering. What we presented to them in the gospel of Jesus Christ is lasting. It's not something that just, you know, I was an emotional stir. It was real. It was something that was really real.
Remaining fruit.
And that just did my heart good to see him come in, and he just was so very thankful. I mean, you don't see very many young men that come back and sit down and talk with you, but this young man came back, talked about his experiences, talked about how, you know, he learned so many things at Pacific Garden Mission that now he's using as a as an adult man. And just it's just good to see God's grace and mercy on the life of our our people that come through our doors.
I wish we had like more time. I know that at the end of the program, you're going to actually even, you're going to see more testimonials. So make sure that you stick around for that. Pastor, tell us what else we need to know about this amazing ministry. And we're so grateful for whoever had this vision at the beginning to start this work, and for you all to continue to be a part of it and be the you know, God's the hands and the legs and all the, you know, the extension of Jesus. What else do we need to know about Pacific Garden?
Well, one thing I would say, it is all donor supported. We've been the city has wanted to rent beds from us, and we don't take money from the city. We don't take money from the federal government. Matter of fact, we pay for water now, which we've never done historically. But God's people, and I believe if God wants us in downtown Chicago, you hear of all the issues in downtown, all the shootings and the drugs and the gangs. This is a light in the midst of darkness. And if God can provide for the mission, we're going to be there. So we've been totally dependent upon the people of God for 140 years.
Wow. Yes.
And that's what we continue to be, yes. Solely donor supported.
Yes.
So it is a spiritual battle, and we do covet the prayers.
Yes.
Because the issues are intense.
Yes, yes.
As the gentleman shared with these stories, a lot of these young men are coming out of gangs, they're mm-hmm. coming yes. out of violence.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing that is a joy is the same vision that began in 1877 is the mm-hmm. same vision today. We have not drifted from our core mm-hmm. issue of
that's
the
right.
proclamation
yes.
of the simple gospel of Jesus
yes.
Christ.
Yes.
That's right.
Wow. Would you pray
Amen.
For folks that... might be watching.
Yes.
Maybe, they need to be a part of this
Amen.
Mission.
Sure.
Or maybe they know someone.
Sure.
And would you just pray?
I sure
yep.
will.
Mm-hmm.
Father, we bow before you right now. You are a mighty God.
Yes.
Yes, you are.
And I do think of Pacific Garden Mission. And right now as we're praying, there's somebody walking through the doors.
Mm.
There's a mother with a child draped around her legs. There's a young man unsure of life, and yet he's been dropped off at the mission. And I pray, God, that you'd get a hold of their hearts and lives, that they would come to know you in a very real way.
Yes, Lord.
And I pray for those that are watching. If there's somebody watching that is not saved, that has never come to the point where they've really understood the forgiveness of their sins, God, that you'd open up their heart.
Yeah.
Lord, that they truly would come to know you. And and I pray that people would come alongside Pacific Garden Mission. Lord, you could pay that mortgage off. You can pay that water bill off. You mm-hmm. can pay the grocery bill. God, you own a cattle on a thousand hills.
Mm-hmm.
You can do these things.
Yes.
And we just
yes.
lay it at your feet. We pray mm-hmm. about it. But God, we know it's a spiritual battle.
Mm-hmm.
So Lord, we just take up arms. We take up the weapon of prayer. We
mm-hmm.
seek you. Protect that place,
mm-hmm.
guide that place,
yes.
use that place, anoint
yes.
the preachers that are preaching the gospel right mm-hmm. now.
Mm-hmm.
I pray again that you would touch the hearts of the men, the women, and the children, that you would bless Pacific Garden Mission, use that ministry,
mm-hmm.
use this program
mm-hmm.
to reach folks for your glory.
Yes,
for
Lord.
We pray in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
We want you to know that God loves you with an everlasting love. The Bible tells us that his love is deep. It's wide, it's long, it's
mm.
high, and that his love covers a multitude of sins. There's
yes.
nothing that you could ever do or think or say that would keep you from his love. But all you have to do, like we heard earlier, is just to surrender and
mm.
call on him. God bless you.
Nobody would have told me I would sleep in cars and sleep in abandoned buildings and not take care of my body. But it brings you down to the dogs. That's what cocaine does for you.
If it's possible for a Red Sea to part, if it's possible for a manna to come down from heaven, if it's possible for a virgin to give birth, all things are possible with my supernatural God. Hallelujah.
I didn't have no purpose, no direction. I was truly lost.
About a man being swallowed up with overmuch sorrow. And there's some of us that are here that way. We are swallowed up.
I was terrified. I mean, I couldn't live like this no more, the pain and the suffering.
We look at our past and Satan wants to continue to bang us on our head.
I just felt like a failure because, I couldn't make it.
Look at where you were. There's nobody that would want you. You are hopeless.
There was a time when I wanted to kill myself.
Tried to suicide in my own house.
Tried to take my life quite a few times.
Who would ever want to be near you? You've never done any good. You've sinned so much you can't be forgiven. You are vile and dirty, and that's how it's always going to be.
I gave it my best shot. I'm through with it. I think I'm just going to end it all.
And that's one of his devices. And then we get swallowed up. Man, I ain't no good. Man, I'm never going to change.
I knew for a fact that I was going to hell.
I said, man, I need help.
And he is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight.
I talked to somebody 2 weeks ago who said, and they were crying out, I can't change. Well, that's not what God said.
All of a sudden, I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory. And I realize just how beautiful.
God said, therefore, if any man is in Christ, he is a what? New creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. The Bible says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me.
Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us.
The message of the Word of God is redemption through faith in Jesus Christ, and yes, that people can change.
As I went through the program, I noticed how so many lives were being changed, how people were giving their lives over to Christ, and that just really touched me.
I'm here to testify that the power of Jesus Christ changes lives.
They're right. When you do accept God, you become a different person. You're not the same. And I'm happy, actually, for it.
Jesus Christ is a God who is faithful and true, and your life can be changed this moment.
That even if you come to a place to where you think life is not worth living, there's a Savior out there to show us a different way, and His name is Jesus Christ.
You can have joy.
As soon as I got here, I accepted the Lord, and that's where my paths started shining.
You can have peace that passes all understanding, and I don't care what your background is.
But through the grace of God, He's given me another chance. Another chance.
I don't care what you've done.
Despite how life has, what avenues you've experienced in this life, that it doesn't matter to Him. He can lift you up. He can bring peace in your life. He can put joy in your heart. He can make the impossible possible, just like He did for me.
I don't care how bad, God offers you a pardon tonight, and you can be changed. I don't care what anybody says.
I'm just so grateful. I'm just so grateful that He loves me in spite of me. It's definitely not because of me, because I don't bring a lot to the table. I think I bring less than the little boy who brought the few loaves and a few fish. I bring less than that. But the thing is, it's in His hands, He can do great miracles. And I didn't give Him much to work with. I think the only thing worthwhile that I brought from Fort Lauderdale was a legitimate desire to change. Other than that, I was worthless. And I'm glad that He sought me and bought me with His cleansing blood.
Take care of somebody, heart turns violently inside of mine.